Last year, in the year 2012, we're very blessed. We were nominated by a Colombian, by two CNN heroes, and out of 50,000 nominees around the world, I was honored to be on the top 10 as the only Latin American and Spanish speaking in the whole earth. It was the most beautiful experience because first it was a blessing, it was a surprise, even though we worked with CNN for about 3 or 4 months, and I think we're a winner, and we think that we're having these voices of these girls around the world. And to be sincere, I need these girls to be better off.
Migrar año, indiscutiblemente, aunque a mí no me gusta separar los años de la vida, pero resaltemos, es cuando yo decidí volver a Gaviotas, hacer un proyecto influido por la creatividad, saliéndome de las cajas tradicionales, y que apuntara hacia la sustentabilidad. Y eso fue en el año 68, cuando regresé a Gaviotas para quedarme más de una semana.
What would you do if they didn't pay you a cent? Where do you feel it flow? And for me, all the answers revolve around the same thing: teaching, mentoring, being a change agent, the catalyst, creating ideas, shocking people into reality. And I asked myself at that moment, what in the world am I doing selling hamburgers? That was 6 months before the incident in the classroom. During those 6 months, there was a big debate in my mind. Well, Pedro, you get paid very well, you have stock options, you have two cars, you have bodyguards, you have power, you have influence, you have all these things. You cannot just throw all that overboard. Plus, teaching, basically, just I was making $25 an hour teaching at Los Andes University, so that wouldn't pay for three kids in private schools and for all, you know, for the expenses that I had or that my family had. So when I started giving the talk, I ran one. The first talk was powerful. It was, you know, there's no second opportunity to make a good first impression. And the first talk, I was invited to give it in Maloca, which is a science center here in Bogota, with Nora Lisa Doyos, who's the founder of this. She's a PhD from Yale, brilliant lady. And I gave it to young people in the dorm room of this place, a beautiful setting. And at the end of this talk, Nora Lisa Doyos, the founder of Maloca, and the Minister of Foreign Trade, who I didn't know, came up and gave me a hug. And I thought, if this talk generates a hug from these two ladies who have done so much for the country, maybe there's something powerful here. 6 months later, I got a call from the secretary to the president of the country saying that there was a Millennium Board and that they wanted me to give the talk to the Millennium Board. And it was the founder of a US Air, the Cisneros, the president of Cisneros Group, the president of Cemex, 30 world-class business people, the whole cabinet. I went and gave that talk, and at the end of the talk, Gustavo Cisneros, one of the most influential people in Venezuela, stood up and said, "You know what? I travel through the entire world, and I have never seen anybody that speaks so negatively of their country, not only in their country, but abroad, than Colombians." That comment led to a whole discussion that whole afternoon about the importance of doing what I was doing. And I left that place with basically an unleashed spirit. I said, I've got something very powerful in my hands. I've got to push this. But you know, I was running a U.S. company. People were distrustful. They didn't know why I was doing this. One day, I ran into Mauricio Rodriguez, who was the head of Portafolio, a newspaper. He was part of the El Tiempo group, the most powerful newspaper group in Colombia. And I said, Mauricio, I'm really upset with El Tiempo. He said, why? I said, because how can it be that last Sunday, the year of the day of spirituality, the day of family, the day of peace, how is it that you open the newspaper with such a headline? Mauricio said, Pedro, I was traveling. I didn't see it. What did it say? The headline said, half of the country is bankrupt. The news was that half of the municipalities in Colombia were technically bankrupt. Mauricio said, you know what, Pedro? You're right. We have a bunch of editors of the old guard that think that only bad news sells. I said, well, I have a powerful talk. Invite me, and I'll give it to your editors. 2 weeks later, I was with them. And they were all very, very open, with the exception of one guy who was in the corner sitting like this, with his legs crossed and his arms crossed. And at the end of the talk, he raised his hand and he said, you know what, Mr. Medina? What you're saying is really true. But the reality is that we have so many bad news so many times that we don't have room for the good news. At that moment, all my blood from Antioquia and from Huila and from Santander just spurred up, and I said, you know what, when you make that decision, I make the decision not to open your lousy newspaper. And I left, and I got really scared. I said, tomorrow they're going to publish that the Corral hamburgers are less fattening than the McDonald's hamburgers or something like that, and I'm going to have my sales affected. Well, the following day, there was nothing on the press, and then the following day, there was a news story, 5/8 of a page, very powerful, with a very powerful headline. It's this this story. It said, where are we first? And they published it with our email address in the bottom. And this story generated a tipping point effect. I got 4,000 emails the first 10 months, the first 10 days. A lady, a Colombian lady in Azerbaijan, wrote to me saying, Mr. Medina, I'm really sick and tired of everybody talking negatively of our country. Please send me all your material. This went from push to pull. That year, in 8 months, running McDonald's in 3 boards with 3 kids, teaching a class involving a bunch of different activities, I gave that talk 256 times. Some days I'll do it 5 and 6 times a day. And the talks range from all kinds of opportunities. One day the chief of police called me up, and I gave a talk in front of 65,000 people in the streets in Barrio Kennedy in Bogota. And then we gave a talk to a banking convention, bankers from all over the world, and school groups, and business groups, and all kinds of venues. And some days it was 5 and 6 times a day, and it was my wife would tell me, last night you were giving the talk asleep. I would just repeat the talk, and that talk, which started that year, my big year, 2001, is now the talk that has been given more times to more people in the world, by more people in the world, in the history of Colombia. We have given that talk to 680,000 people in 159 cities in 29 countries, 5,300 times. I've trained 1,800 people to give the talk. Not all of them give a talk, but I've trained 1,800 people, all kinds of people, from 14-year-olds to 84-year-olds, from business presidents to students to beauty queens, all kinds of people. And this became the project for the rest of my life. Now we run a foundation, which is called Yo Creo en Colombia. We're starting a project, which is Yo Creo en America Latina, I believe in Latin America. And basically we do asset-based development. We develop contents, powerful contents, through which we engage Colombians and Latin Americans in thinking differently, in seeing ourselves in a different way, and in relating to our people in a different way. So it has to do with self-image, it has to do with social capital, and in telling our story in a different way, it has to do with marketing. My big year, 2001, powerful. Started with a frustration, Listen to frustrations. Frustrations are powerful and persistent. We'll be right back.